Welcome to St. Mary's. Please stand.
We were waiting without hope, without light, till from heaven you came running. There was mercy in your eyes to fulfill the law and prophets
from a virgin came the world.
From a throne of endless glory to a cradle in the dirt.
Your mercy, great is your love. We glorify your holy name. We give you thanks, Lord. You're the great high priest. You're the Lion of Judah. You're the King of kings, the Lord of lords. You're the Lamb of God. You're the King of kings, Lord. Praise you, Lord. Glorify. You're all loving, Lord. Kuria kara shalala, kuria kara shalala.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and love of God, the communion of the Holy Spirit, be with you all.
And with your spirit.
So good evening, everyone.
Good evening, Father.
So welcome to Parish of St. Mary's, and those who are visiting to celebrate this great feast day of the Companions of the Cross, the Exaltation of the Holy Cross. I see the Servants of the Cross sisters here, the Queenship of Mary. I'm sure many of you here who are lay associates who are here, And so it's always good to come together as one family, you know, to celebrate this great feast day. Brothers and sisters, let us acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate these sacred mysteries. I confess to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have gravely sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done, what I have failed to do, through my most grievous fault. Therefore, I ask Blessed Mary, Ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May mighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Set this place on fire, O Lord. Set our hearts on fire for you, O Lord. We glorify you. We give you thanks. We give you glory. Kuriya kara shalalala kuriya kara shalala. Kuriya kara shalalala kuriya.
We glorify you, we give you thanks. Glory to the Father, glory to the Son, glory to the Holy Spirit. We give you praise, we give you thanks. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. You are all holy, you are all good, you are all loving, O Lord. Praise you, O Lord. Kuriya kara shalalala, kiriya kara shalalala, kuriya. We give you praise, Lord. Descend upon this place. Let us pray. O God, who willed that your only begotten Son should undergo the cross to save the human race, grant, we pray, that we who have known this mystery on earth may merit the grace of his redemption in heaven. To our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from the book of Numbers. As they journeyed across the desert, the Israelites left Mount Hor by the way to the Red Sea to go around the land of Edom. But the people became impatient on the way. The people spoke against God and against Moses. Why have you brought us up out of Egypt to die in the wilderness? For there is no food and no water, and we detest this miserable food. Then the Lord sent poisonous serpents among the people, and they bit the people so that many Israelites died. The people came to Moses and said, "We have sinned by speaking against the Lord and against you. Pray to the Lord to take away the serpents from us." So Moses prayed for the people, and the Lord said to Moses, "Make a poisonous serpent and set it on a pole, and everyone who is bitten shall look at it and live." So Moses made a serpent of bronze and put it upon a pole, and whenever a serpent bit someone, that person would look at the serpent of bronze and live. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Incline your ear to the words of my mouth.
water dark sailing from of home. Do not forget the works of the Lord. Do not forget the works of the Lord. When God killed them, the people sought for him. They repented and sought him earnestly. They remember that God was their rock, the Most High God, their to him with their tongues. Their heart was not steadfast toward him. They were not true to his covenant. Do not forget of the Lord. Yet he, being compassionate, forgave their iniquity and did not destroy them. Often he restrained his anger
A reading from the letter of Paul to the Philippians. Though Christ was in the form of God, he did not regard equality with God as something to be exploited, but emptied himself, taking the form of a slave. Being born in human likeness and being found in human form, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God highly exalted him and gave him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bend in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus said to Nicodemus, "No one has ascended into heaven except the one who descended from heaven, the Son of Man. And just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but may have eternal life. Indeed, God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
A few weeks ago, I shared with the youth at the youth group the story of Saint Dominic Savio appearing to Saint John Bosco so that Saint John Bosco could have a hint of heaven. And Saint Dominic Savio was one of Saint John Bosco's students, and Dominic died at the age of 14. Super holy guy. But I was telling him the story. I told the youth, I said, "Listen, this is a story my dad told me. I'm just going from memory." I said, "But I would love to source the story. I like to source cool stories so I can get the story right." And I told him, I said, "Hey, if ever you come across this story in a book, you come tell me." "Well, would you believe," right when I finished, at the end of the youth group, one of the mothers who was sitting in at the back of the church, she comes up to me, she has a book in her hand, she says, "This is the book, and here's the story." Like, isn't that cool? Now, the reason I bring this up is I have another cool story. Again, I've heard this. I hope I got the facts pretty much straight. If you know the source on this story, please let me know. I think it's a little white French book I read, you know, when I was a seminary. But the point is, it's the story during the French Revolution of some kind of military commander or general or captain who would go on these campaigns with his soldiers, and they would go out to the countryside in France where there was a lot of pious Catholics, and they would destroy crucifixes. And one day, the military commander had the idea to bring his little daughter along, just a child, on one of these campaigns of destroying crucifixes. And the little girl, she didn't have a clue what this was all about. And she saw these soldiers, these men, destroying these crucifixes. And she didn't know who this man was on the cross, but as she witnessed this, she somehow had this sense, she knew that man on that cross, he did nothing wrong. He's innocent. That man is perfectly innocent. And he loves us. He doesn't deserve this, and yet this is what's happening to him, and he is bearing this with love. And as she was experiencing, she somehow knew that this man was perfectly innocent, perfectly good, did nothing wrong, and loved us, loves us, so much so that she opened her heart to the Lord Jesus. She knew somehow that the love that this man has is a love beyond all telling, a love that no one in this world could ever give her. She was pierced to the heart by what she saw happening. And then a few years later, when she was, I don't know what, 18 years old, she informed her father that she was going to join a convent and become a nun. And her father was horrified, shocked, beside himself. And he said, "Why in the world would you want to be a nun? You know, we're done with religion." And she said, "You remember when you were destroying those crucifixes? I discovered who that is. And I fall in love with him. And I'm giving my life to him. I've given him my heart." And this is the power, the mysterious power of the cross, of Christ crucified. And we see this. Let's begin in Zechariah.
Zechariah chapter 12 and 13, it's prophesied, and this is in the context of prophesying the coming of the Messiah, the Savior who will save us. The Lord says, I will pour out on the house of David and on the inhabitants of Jerusalem a spirit of mercy and supplication. A grace is going to be given. Something is going to be poured out. A spirit of mercy and supplication, so that when they looked on him whom they have pierced, they will mourn for him as one mourns for an only child. They will grieve for him as one grieves over a firstborn. On that day, a fountain will be opened for the house of David and the inhabitants of Jerusalem to purify from sin and uncleanness. Now, who is this man who is pierced, who is thrust through? We know, of course, it's the Lord Jesus. In John chapter 19, it says, but one soldier thrust his lance into the side and to his side, and immediately blood and water flowed out. The Lord Jesus, what's the prayer in the Chapel of Divine Mercy? Oh, blood and water which gushed forth from the heart of Jesus as a fountain of mercy for us, an inexhaustible fountain. That's the cross. It's this fountain of mercy, that it's this mercy that makes us new. And so we hear in Numbers, we heard in Numbers, you know, Moses is instructed to make this bronze serpent on a pole. Very interesting. He's commanded, make a seraph and mount it on a pole, and everyone who is bitten when he sees it will live. The person who sees, who gazes upon this, lives. You see, everyone was dying. They were dying. They grumbled against the Lord. They offended the Lord grievously. And they were being bitten by serpents. They were being, you know, punished for their rebellion. And they were dying. They were dying. But the Lord gave them this grace. You look at that and you will live. You won't die. And mysterious. What a mysterious symbol. But the Lord Jesus, he points to it. We heard it in today's gospel. Our Lord Jesus says, and just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the desert, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, so that everyone who believes in him may have eternal life. Everyone who believes, everyone who sees and believes doesn't die. You're not going to die. In this world filled with sin, filled with you could say mortal sin, we're dying, we're all dying spiritually, we've lost our inheritance. The Lord says, you look at him who is pierced, and a grace will be given to you, a spirit of repentance, and blood and water will gush forth from the spring, and you will live. You'll live forever. You'll have eternal life. This is the fountain. And from this time on, from the heart of Jesus being pierced and the fountain being opened, the blood and water which makes us new being opened, there's been this grace. This grace, like we hear from this young girl in France, she sees, she believes, she receives this grace, she's cut to the heart, and she lives for all of eternity, becoming a bride of Christ. Now, this grace continues. When Jesus was dying on the cross, it says in Mark chapter 15, Jesus gave a loud cry and breathed his last. When the centurion who stood facing him saw how he breathed his last, he said, truly, this man was the Son of God. You see this grace beginning. People are looking. They're looking with eyes wide open. They're looking with open hearts and with faith, and they're being touched in the heart. They're being pierced. Their hearts are being pierced, and they're believing and receiving the gift of eternal life and living forever. And again, this is the grace throughout the ages. Some of you might know one of the priests in our community, Father Terry Donahue. Maybe you've heard his story. He was at university, MIT, as a matter of fact. And he didn't believe. I think he said he was an atheist and he was living a broken life. And somehow someone got a cassette tape to him with a priest who was sharing the gospel, and he somehow decided to listen to it very reluctantly. And he's listening, and the priest says, God loves you just as you are right now. He loves you no matter where you're at, how broken. He loves you just as you are right now. And when he heard that, he pressed stop, he pressed rewind, he played it again. He said, you trying to tell me that God loves me? Like right here and now? And then he kept listening. The priest said, listen, if you don't know the love of God, get yourself a crucifix and look at it. Just look at it. That's the love of God. And I think Father Terry said he didn't have a crucifix in his dorm room. So he just got on his knees and he imagined Jesus dying on the cross. And as he began to do this, the floodgates opened and he was inundated. He was flooded with the love of God. He experienced a love that changed his life forever. He believed and was given eternal life to live forever. That's the grace we're talking about. That's the power of the cross available to everyone, the grace the Lord wants every single one of us to have. Now, we know that the eyes are the window to the soul. You know, there's something about the eyes, both physical and spiritual. And to me, it's kind of like if the soul or the heart, it's kind of like a greenhouse, okay? A greenhouse filled with soil and seeds, but there's no light. It's completely covered. It's in complete darkness. There's nothing living inside until we see, until we look, that gaze of faith. We open the eyes of our souls and the Lord's light comes in into this greenhouse ready to receive this light. And it's not just any ordinary light. It's a blinding, powerful light. It just fills this greenhouse with powerful light. And it's kind of like a misty, moist light. It brings everything that is needed for this greenhouse to just spring to life with beauty and flowers and plants and fruits. It just be the interior soul. You see, the soul is a garden, the garden of the soul. It's meant to be beautiful and delightful and filled with life. And when we gaze upon the Lord with faith and with love, and he comes in and radiates his life, his spirit, his divine light within us, the beauty begins to live inside of us and begins to radiate to others. And one of the signs of that is the joy. There's a joy, even through difficult times and hardships. And this is what the Lord wants for each one of us. As a matter of fact, we're created for this for all of eternity. The whole mystery of the contemplative, for all of eternity, we will gaze upon him, the beatific vision. We will see him face to face. We will see him as he is. And this will be a transforming union, a gaze beyond all telling. And John speaks about this in 1 John 3. He says, see what love the Father has bestowed on us that we may be called children of God. And so we are. Beloved, we are God's children now. What we shall be has not yet been revealed. We know that when it is revealed, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. This gaze of love that unites us to God, that transforms us, which is meant to begin already in this life. By looking at the symbol of the love of God, Christ crucified, there's the love of God. And again, each one of us, we're called to slow down. I tell the youth group, you got to become recollects. You got to learn to recollect yourself. If you got the monkey brain, you're buzzing, you know, all the time with your phone and your iPad and this and that, you'll never become a contemplative. And it's the contemplative gaze that gives life. You know, I'm not joking. Don't laugh. I'm not joking. It's okay. I appreciate it. But it's true. We can go about all of our busy things, even do religious things, but you have to have that point of contemplation where you slow enough and you see, and that requires a recollection, a stillness. to be able to gaze upon him who was pierced and experience this spirit of repentance that gives eternal life, the life that comes from the cross where the heart was pierced and the fountain was opened and we were made clean and made new and given eternal life. So let's gaze upon the cross. Let's become companions of the cross, servants of the cross. Let's love the cross. Let's embrace the cross and let's proclaim Christ crucified to a dying world. People need to see, to believe, and to live.
Let's now stand and offer up our intentions to the Lord. Let us now pray to God the Father, who loved the world so much that he gave his only Son to die for us upon the cross. Your response, through the power of the cross, hear us, O Lord. Power of the cross, hear us, O Lord. That a church on earth may fight on to victory beneath the standard of the cross, let us pray to the Lord. To the power of the cross, hear us, O Lord, that people of every nation and culture may find freedom and peace through the one whom God raised on high. Let us pray to the Lord.
To the power of the cross,
hear us, O Lord, that those who stand in need of God's mercy and forgiveness may find hope in the cross of Christ as a way to peace and reconciliation. Let us pray to the Lord.
To the power of the cross,
that the sick may see in the cross of Jesus the hope of complete healing and recovery. Let us pray to the Lord.
Power of the cross, hear us, O Lord.
That those who sleep in Christ may be cleansed of their sins through the blood of Christ's sacrifice. Let us pray to the Lord.
Power of the cross, hear us, O Lord.
Loving Father, in this life and the next, our hope is in the cross. Grant our petitions as we praise you for your mercies through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
Where all the love I've ever
brothers and sisters, my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all his holy church.
May this oblation, O Lord, which on the altar of the cross canceled the offense of the whole world, cleanse us, we pray, for all our sins, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, for you placed the salvation of the human race on the wood of the cross so that where death arose, life might again spring forth, and the evil one who conquered on a tree might likewise on a tree be conquered through Christ our Lord. Through him, the angels praise your majesty, dominions adore, and powers tremble before you. Heaven and the virtues of heaven and the blessed seraphim worship together with exaltation. May our voices, we pray, join with theirs in humble praise as we acclaim. Indeed, holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. And you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread. Giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, O Lord, until you come again.
Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray upon the oblation of your church and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you willed to reconcile us to yourself. Grant that we, who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit, may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, and with all the saints on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May the sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth with your servant Francis our Pope, Marcel our Bishop, Ivan his auxiliary, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family, whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world, to our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who are pleasing to you at their passing from this life. Give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Lord. Through him and with him and in him, O God Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. At the Savior's command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer each other the sign of peace. The Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I'm not worthy that you should enter under my roof,
but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
'Twas my cross you bore, so I could live in the freedom you died for. And now my life is yours, and I will sing of the goodness forever.
Worthy is your name.
Well, at Mass, I just had an image of the cross, but Jesus is not there, but it's his Sacred Heart. And it has been pierced, and blood and water was gushing forth. And angels and saints praising this cross, and this blood and water gush forth. And we're the recipient of those graces, water to purify us from our sins, blood to give us life. So let's just take this time to really thank the Lord for the graces that he is bestowing upon us right now, and gaze at him with love. So Lord Jesus, we thank you. We thank you for dying on the cross, for love for each and every one of us, so that you will be able to shed your blood and water, so that we'll be able to receive all the graces that you want us to have. Thank you. Thank you for the cross. Let's now stand. Let us pray. Having been nourished by your holy banquet, we beseech you, Lord Jesus Christ, to bring those you have redeemed by the word of your life-giving cross to the glory of the resurrection, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
So please be seated. I would like to invite the servants of the cross as their new applicants is going to give a testimony.
Good evening. My name is Sister Allison, and on behalf of the Servants of the Cross, we want to introduce to you one of our newest applicants, Caroline Protasevich.
Thank you. So as Sister Allison mentioned, my name is Caroline, and I'm a first-year applicant. Just a little background about myself. I was born and raised in Winnipeg, Manitoba, and I have a family of four, so I'm the oldest, and I have a younger brother. Growing up, I had a mix of traditions in my household, so my father is Ukrainian Catholic, and my mother, Roman Catholic. It was my mother who raised us in the faith, took me and my brother to church, and enrolled us in catechism. And that played a huge role in my relationship with the Lord and just growing in my faith. Have you ever been afraid of hearing what God might want to speak to you? I have. I spent years trying to grow in my relationship with the Lord, but simultaneously plugged my ears in attempts of any time the Lord tried to speak to me. And let me tell you, it's not a good combination. When I was 13, I had a religious sister as my catechism teacher. She had briefly shared her vocation story with us, and having heard it, I was terrified. At the time, I dreamed of getting married and having a family. So upon hearing that this sister desired the same thing in her youth, but realized God's call for her was something different, just didn't sit with me. I felt that, oh no, God is going to do the same thing to me. I'm going to be a religious sister. There's my dreams. Throughout the rest of grade 8 and into high school, God continued to grow me little by little. I began to develop a prayer life, got involved in my parish youth group, and the Lord increased my desire to learn more about the faith. In grade 12, I came across an advertisement for a discernment retreat. I thought this would be my confirmation from God that I will get married. Around the same time, I felt a worsening tension within my heart whenever I thought about my own plans and plugged my ears to any possibility of religious life. I began to realize I had to at least be open to different paths of life if I truly wanted to discern. During the retreat, I had an opportunity to have a one-on-one with a religious sister. My plans were to ask her how she found out her vocation, and she told me a little bit, but then she ended up saying that she sensed the Lord had something else that I had on my heart to share. I immediately knew she was referring to the wounds of guilt and shame I had been carrying from my past. I allowed myself to pour out my heart to her. In doing so, I finally gave myself permission to receive the mercy and love the Lord had been calling me to embrace for so long. The Lord had shown me his love and forgiveness were a much bigger part of my discernment journey than I realized. I encountered God in a very personal way that day, which grew my openness to hear the Lord, since I could see his goodness and faithfulness more clearly. When I was in my first year of university, I met a campus group called Catholic Christian Outreach. Maybe you've heard of it. Taking the faith studies enabled me to see Jesus as someone I could relate to on a deeper, more personal level. That same year, I attended a Rise Up conference, which the Lord used as an opportunity to grow my attraction to religious life. In particular, I was drawn to the unique habit of a sister with the Servant of the Cross. While I was too afraid to go and speak to her, I noticed her again when I was praying in the chapel and decided to keep their community in my mind when I got home. Following the conference, I continued with the faith studies and began to slowly research religious communities, talk with religious sisters regarding vocation, and eventually began to pray about the growing desire I had for this way of life. In my second year of university, I began to question my studies. As I saw the Lord open my heart more to religious life, my desire to serve God only grew. And the future I'd planned with my studies became less and less important. That year, I knew God was calling me to go on mission with CCO in the summer within my own city. I got to lead faith studies and even evangelize in public. I felt full and on fire with God's love from being able to serve the Lord in this way. Knowing and finally having experienced how I could serve the Lord left me hungering for more. At the start of my third year of studies, I felt unsettled about continuing school. Midway into the semester, I came across a virtual come and see hosted by the Servants of the Cross. This was a turning point for me as I became certain of two things. One, I became certain that God was calling me to religious life. And the second was that I felt called to discern if I should continue at school. I spent the rest of the semester discerning, and since the Lord was calling me to drop my nets and follow him. Wait, what? As frightful as it was to abandon my studies and tell my parents, I was assured that I was following the Lord's guidance as I took the next step of going on a discernment retreat with the Servants of the Cross. Following the retreat, I gave my yes to what I sensed the Lord calling me to apply to the community. From there, the Lord only continued his pursuit of love for me, walking with me each step of the way. I felt more peace and joy than I had ever before, and I couldn't be more delighted to be on this adventure he has taken me on. The Lord showed me all along that there is nothing to be afraid of, and that a little bit of openness can take you on the greatest adventure God has in store for you. So, what does God have in store for you? My advice, be not afraid. Thank you for your time and for listening, letting me share about God's goodness. And please continue to pray for my vocation and our community, Servants of the Cross. Thank you.
beautiful testimony there by Caroline. And so young women here, if the Lord is steering in your heart, maybe to consider religious life, we have two beautiful sister communities here, the Servants of the Cross and the Queenship of Mary Sisters. But of course, we have our vocations director here also, the Companions of the Cross. Young men, if the Lord is calling you, if you want to have an adventure, join the Companions of the Cross. So there's so many people to thank, but first of all, I would like to thank Father Mark for giving us a wonderful, inspiring homily. Thank you so much, Father Mark. And also my brother priest here, Father Lawrence, who's the vocation director, and also Father Francis Donnelly, who's living in this residence. Father Roger couldn't join us because Father Roger is in Detroit. Two of our seminarians are going to be ordained as a deacon this Saturday, right? And then next year, we will have three ordinations to the priesthood. Okay, so please pray. Yeah. Also, thanks to the choir and everyone who helped organizing this event. There's also a reception organized by the Servants of the Cross. Thank you so much, Servants of the Cross. Okay, so you're all invited. And thank you for all of you who have come here to join this celebration. Okay, amen. God bless. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Bow down for the blessing. Father in heaven, we come before you as your beloved sons and daughters. We just ask, Lord, that you pour upon us, Lord, your blessing. Pour upon us, Lord, the fire of your love, the Holy Spirit, that may descend upon each and every one of us, that we may truly believe that we are loved by you. Lord, strengthen our faith in your Son, Jesus Christ, that we may be temple of the Holy Spirit also, that we may be able to do the mission that you have called us to do, which is to make disciples of all nations. We ask intercession of Mary, Saint Joseph, and all the angels and saints for all our intentions. And we ask all of this in Jesus' name. Amen. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Go in peace.
Thanks be to God.
Saint Michael, the Archangel, defend us in battle. Be our protection against the wickedness and snares of the devil. May God rebuke him, we humbly pray. And that our Prince of the Heavenly Host, by the power of God, cast into hell Satan and all the evil spirits who prowl through the world, seeking the ruin of souls. Amen.